Oh, hey.
Didn't see you there. It's me, Pygmalion, everyone's favorite play from 1913. Today, we're talking about beef. The other week, I had the most surreal restaurant experience of my entire life. Whenever we ordered food, the waiters would do a juggling trick with like the knives and the meat. Whenever they finished something off, they would do like a flourish with salt and then cry out, "Salt Bay." I assumed initially this was just the old waiter's attempt to relate to the youths with a 4-year-old meme. And then on the wall behind me, there was a giant portrait of Salt Bay. And then we realized this is just a restaurant that he opened up with the Twitter clout. Despite it being a little bit weird to have a really fancy restaurant based on a dead meme, it was still like the best meal I've probably ever had in my life and probably will ever have. Also probably the most expensive meal I'll ever have. And it was because it was all Wagyu beef. And it got me thinking, why is Wagyu so good? Why is it so expensive? Also, I want to sculpt a cow face. So let's get into that now.
So first and foremost, how expensive exactly is Wagyu beef? Let me tell your tiny little eardrums. You can get steaks online for anywhere between like $100 and $300 a pound, but you'd have to pay a premium for Wagyu steaks from restaurants, because that's just how restaurants work. For example, from the Salt Bay restaurant, you could get a big ol' honkin' tomahawk steak covered in gold leaf for just $1,800, which is a mere 6 weeks of work toiling away at a minimum wage job. Even the comparatively more reasonably priced $100, $150 steaks are still like a week's worth of groceries or like an entire month's electricity bill, if you're not running a crypto mining operation, at least. So yeah, I would say that is a bit expensive. Okay, but why are these cuts of meat so expensive? It's not like cows are some endangered species. It's not like we're making these steaks out of panda flesh or anything. I mean, over 1 billion cows exist. But Wagyu beef, of course, doesn't just come from any old Angus or Jersey cow out there. They come from a few specific Japanese breeds that are raised with exacting standards. And the history of these breeds is absolutely fascinating, and it's like a microcosm of Japanese history. Cows were, of course, originally domesticated around present-day Iran from the aurochs, which sounds like a fantasy beast, but is just pretty much just looks like a cow. Since Japan is an island, it's not like aurochs just waddled over there and started setting up shop, so cattle had to be brought over on boats. Cattle were brought over around the 2nd century CE, AD, whatever you want to call it, around the time rice was also brought over. It's unclear exactly what breed native Japanese cows would call their cousins on the cow family tree, but I think it'd be fair to assume they're more closely related to Chinese breeds than like longhorn cattle. The way cattle were used by ancient Japanese peoples was pretty unique. They didn't really eat their meat or extract dairy from them. Cows were mostly used as draught animals. Let me see how to pronounce that.
Draft.
What? Why the fuck is it spelled like that? Okay, whatever. So they ended up being more what we would maybe call oxen instead of just cows. Cows were incredibly expensive. Most peasants probably couldn't afford one, and those who were well off enough to get their hands on a cow would probably hesitate to eat it because it was so expensive. It'd be like if someone today got a Siamese cat with like a champion bloodline and just ate it. Supposedly there were some cultural reasons around not eating beef. There wasn't really citations for this. It was just like someone heard that priests said don't eat beef, and that's all I'm going off of. But really it was probably just because cows were way too expensive to go around eating them. Basically, pre-industrial Japanese dudes weren't really using their cows to their fullest potential. Like, they weren't making ice cream or butter statues or anything. But this might have actually ended up making these cows better in the future. You see, when Westerners showed up and, long story short, told Japan, "We're trading now, whether you like it or not," they also brought cows along with them. Not sure why someone wanted to subject cows to being hauled across the ocean, but regardless, during the Meiji Restoration between 1868 and 1887, around 2,600 cows were hauled hauled over, which probably sucked for both the cows and the sailors on the ship. But don't worry, the sacrifice of all of these noble creatures was kind of for nothing. I mean, at first it seemed like these newfangled cows were cool. Farmers started enthusiastically crossbreeding the imported cows with their local native cow strains, and seemed like it was going well at first. The milk yields were a lot higher, the cows were a lot bigger so you could get more meat off their carcasses, but pretty soon people started noticing the meat from these crossbred cattle just wasn't as good. The meat wasn't as tender, it wasn't as marbled, it just wasn't as good. So by 1910, most crossbreeding between local Japanese cows and imported cows stopped, but the damage was done. Before all the crossbreeding happened, there were give or take half a dozen distinct varieties of different cows in Japan. So the hybrids made from the regional breeds were also therefore distinct from one another. They were distinct enough from each other that in 1944, the existing hybrids were separated into four official breeds. Yeah, I don't really know why some guys were out there in war-torn Japan categorizing cows, but, you know, someone had to do it eventually, I suppose. The hybrids, or now the breeds, had mostly superficial differences based on both the regional Japanese variety that they descended from and also the imported breeds they were mixed with. So, for example, the Japanese Black, which is by far the most common variant, and also the sort of cow whose face I'm referencing for this sculpture, it developed from cows in the southwest of Japan and then were mixed with European breeds like the Devon and Shorthorn and Holstein. Yeah, so I don't think it would really be super interesting to sit here and list off a bunch of breeds that mix together to make modern day Wagyu cows. And by the way, Wagyu pretty much just translates to mean Japanese cow or Japanese beef. So saying Wagyu cow is kind of like saying ATM machine. But I will tell you what the four modern breeds are, at least. The Japanese Shorthorn, Japanese Polled, Japanese Brown, or Japanese Red, and finally, the Japanese Black. The Japanese Black is by far and away the most common. Japan's Wagyu herd is somewhere between 90 and 95% Japanese Black cows. So if you ever get a slab of Wagyu on your plate, it's probably from a Japanese Black. But what exactly happened to all the native Japanese breeds? Did they all just get crossbred into oblivion? For the most part, yeah, pretty much. They pretty much just morphed to become the modern Japanese cow breeds. However, there are two tiny pockets left of pure native Japanese breeds. They're the Mishima and the Kachinoshima, and they managed to avoid the fate of hybridization by just living on remote islands. It's a pretty good strategy. It would be pretty interesting to see how the meat of these native breeds compares to that of crossbred Wagyus, but if you're in the Anglosphere, it's really unlikely you'll ever see one of these two native Japanese cows come across your plate. The most recent census of Mashima cows put their population at 108. So yeah, you're probably not going to find that in a grocery store. On the upside, these cows were declared a national treasure. Not sure if that's going to help their population bounce back, but, you know, it's something. Okay, so what about all of the other Wagyus in Japan's herd? Why is their meat so expensive? Like, sure, in the grand scheme of things, 1 million cows isn't that much compared to the total billion cows in various farms across the world. But that doesn't sound like it would be a small enough number to make the price of their meat so high. Like, sure, artificial scarcity is a thing, but that doesn't sound that scarce. And yeah, it's not. But there's also a difference between just a hunk of Wagyu and, like, a hunk of Wagyu. I mean, like, a piece of the premium stuff, a piece of the creme de la creme, or the bœuf de la bœuf. Like, the same way not all fish roe is caviar, not all Wagyu is Kobe beef. However, the difference between Kobe and other Wagyu is significantly more arbitrary than the difference between other fish roe and caviar. Like, caviar comes from a specific species of fish. Kobe beef comes from cow. Just like any other Texas Roadhouse steak. I'm sure the makers of Kobe beef would love you to think their cows were descendants of the cattle of Helios or something, but no, they're just cows. It's not a whole nother species, so how is it delineated? Okay, wait, let's back up a little bit. What exactly is Kobe beef, and why is it comparable to caviar? Like, we already know Wagyu is good, we already know Wagyu tastes good, but what's Kobe beef? How is it different than Wagyu? Let's figure it out. So, Kobe beef, along with Matsusaka beef and Yanizawa beef, are the best known brands of premium Wagyu beef. There are several other brands that produce Wagyu in general and a few other designer brands, but these three are definitely like the Gucci's and the Pradas of Wagyu. Each of these brands have exacting standards and most definitely have a superiority complex. Matsusaka beef, for example, has to be taken from cows reared specifically in, believe it or not, the Matsusaka area, which is in the Mei Prefecture. Every calf that will be sold as Matsusaka beef has to be registered with a management company. And as a store, if you want to sell Matsusaka beef, you have to get a certification from the Matsusaka Beef Cattle Association. There's even this whole system in place for these cows where they have an ID number that you can take and put in a database, and then it spits back like this cow's whole life history, like its birthday, birth location, death day, like its whole 23andMe analysis. And they only sell the meat of female cows, specifically of virgin female cows. You know, obviously making a baby takes a lot out of a heifer and then would reduce her meat quality, but it still sounds kind of creepy. Like, what are you gonna do with that? Go to a temple and be like, oh, rain god, smile on us, here's the meat of a virgin cow. Okay, so the other most famous brand, if not the singular most famous brand, Kobe beef, is a little bit less creepy, but their standards might be even higher than Matsusaka beef. Although, they do also slaughter male cows. So if you want to support the fight for equality, you gotta buy Kobe beef. But the male cow specifically has to be castrated. And Kobe beef isn't just taken from any cow, and it isn't just taken from any Japanese black. It's taken from a specific strain of Japanese blacks called the Taijima. Furthermore, these Taijima Japanese blacks must be born in the Hyōjō Prefecture, and they also have to be reared on a farm in the Hyōgo Prefecture. And their carcasses, which, by the way, have to be no more than 500 kilos. Wait, no. Sorry. Specifically, 499.9 kilos have to be processed at a select few slaughterhouses. And also, their meat quality score has to be a 4 or 5 out of 5. And their yield grade has to be an A or B. And finally, their marbling ratio has to score a 6 or higher on the marbling scale, which goes from 1 to 12. Anyway, only about 3,000 Taijima Japanese blacks are slaughtered per year to make Kobe beef, along with another 2,600 heads of other Japanese blacks to produce Matsusaka beef. And of course, it's no guarantee that 100% of the carcasses will produce grade A or impeccably marbled beef. But realistically, the conditions these cows are raised in aren't that different than any other random cow who ends up just getting made into dog food. So this whole thing is pretty much just a matter of artificial scarcity. If you wanted to summarize the whole video, it would just be, yep, artificial scarcity. Cows. But, you know, we're here for the fun facts along the way. But pretty much if Kobe beef producers wanted to, I'm sure they could increase the Taijima population by several orders of magnitude over a decade or so. But like, I don't know why they would want to do that. I'm sure they're all making bank right now. I mean, this whole thing is pretty much just like purses. Like, sure, maybe Chanel bags are made with marginally higher materials and better designs than some random bag from like Kohl's, but the reason people want them is because they're Chanel bags, and there's the whole mythos around them, and yeah, they're prettier, higher quality materials, but I don't think they should be 1,000 times more expensive necessarily. Regardless, people are attracted to authenticity and will pay for it. Even if a slab of Kobe beef tastes exactly like another piece of Wagyu, people will pay for the Kobe beef name brand. Let's talk about how these Kobe and Matsusaka beef cows are actually produced. There's a whole lot of mythos surrounding their rearing. It's kind of hard to pull fact from fiction. Like, there's reports out there that are saying these cows get massages every day, but then there's counter reports that are like, no, it's just a traditional brushing technique used to relax the cows. There's also reports that they're fed beer to fatten them up for a couple months before slaughter. When they're most of the way grown, they don't have as high of an appetite, but farmers want to engorge these cows as much as possible to get the marbling. And apparently a good way to do it is just give them beer and it enhances their appetite. Look, I don't know if they're getting sloshed over there or not, but, you know, at the end of the day, they're mostly being fed grain and that's about it. They're just raised more or less like any other cow is, to say, for the most part. They're probably not having a great time, but, you know, that's okay. They're probably not going out and about and grazing, because grazing requires movement, and movement burns fat. Or does it? Here's the thing. Movement and exercise might actually be good for fat deposits, or at least for the sort of fat deposits you want out of a beef cow, the sort of fat deposits that give their meat a lot of marbling. Beef quality is largely determined by how well marbled a cut is. A grader will look at a slice of the ribeye muscle, specifically between the 12th and 13th rib, and then based on the amount of marbling, the space between the marbling, things like that, they give it a grade, like we said before, between 1 and 12. 1 being virtually no marbling, and 12 is the most luscious marbling imaginable. And no, that doesn't mean a piece of meat with a marbling grade of 12 is just like a bucket of lard. Lard is made mostly out of intermuscular fat or adipose fat, so that's the sort of fat that sits between an animal's muscles and like around their internal organs and stuff. But the sort of fat that marbles meat is specifically intramuscular fat, inside of muscle fibers, so like between the actual cells are little tiny fat nuggets, and this is what intramuscular fat is. And intramuscular fat, or just marbling, is incredibly important for the flavor of the meat. So think about just cooking a boneless, skinless chicken breast. If you don't slather that thing in oil or butter or something, it's going to turn out dry. I guess unless you're a better cook than I am. But the easiest way to keep a piece of meat juicy is just dumping fat on it. Just dumping lard on it. Like, think about roasted Thanksgiving turkeys if your family's as crappy of cooks as mine is. The only part that is even remotely edible often ends up just being the skin where the butter was rubbed on the turkey before going in the oven, and then the rest of it is just, like, mega dry. And that's because turkey is a pretty lean meat. It doesn't have a bunch of fat in it. But if you cook up something that has a lot of fat marbled in it, it kind of retain the juiciness and the flavor and stuff. What I do know is that intramuscular fat is also super important for exercise. The fat nuggets that compose intramuscular fat are readily accessible to the mitochondria of, so they're right there to be taken to decompose and make ATP or whatever. And there's some evidence that, at least in humans, exercising encourages a higher buildup of intramuscular fat versus intermuscular fat. So obviously nowadays, very few modern farm cows are getting a lot of exercise, if any exercise. So the reason Kobe beef cows have so much more marbling than most other cows isn't because they're out there running marathons while Angus cows in Oklahoma are lounging around on couches. So the reason that Wagyu cows have such high marbling in their meat is most likely just due to genetics. Japanese strains of cows were, like I mentioned before, pretty much only used as draft animals. So they were probably specifically selectively bred for things like endurance. Cows in the West, on the other hand, were selectively bred primarily, or at least were also selectively bred for things like dairy production and just sheer size. It wouldn't be surprising if there was a correlation between an amount of endurance a cow has and an amount of intramuscular fat deposits that cow has. And so it would make sense that selectively breeding cows to be highly effective draft animals would also, as a byproduct, yield cows that produced richly marbled meat. So whether or not it was a byproduct of them being raised for draft animal or just a coincidence, Wagyu's predisposition to creating really marbled meat is almost definitely a genetic gift. Well, maybe not a gift for the cows, it is for us at least. Nowadays, really within the past 10 years or so, Wagyus have started making their way around the globe. But farmers in other countries like America, Canada, Australia, the UK might have some trouble getting a full herd of Wagyu going. So even like an Angus cow, which is pretty much the premium cow in America, will go for $2,000 or $3,000, whereas some Wagyus for auction go for like $30,000. So a lot of people who are just getting these Wagyus are crossbreeding them with other cows just so they can have any cows at all, really. Probably the most common cow Wagyu are getting crossed with are Angus cows, and the combination of Angus and Wagyu ends up being called Wangus beef. It's pretty funny. But people who have tried both Wangus beef and also just regular Wagyu, Kobe, whatever, they say that it just isn't quite as good. Part of this might also be due to the fact that, at least in America, anyone can pretty much market their beef as Kobe beef. The dudes who are in charge of processing and ensuring the quality of Kobe beef, the Kobe Beef Marketing and Distribution Promotion Association, they don't have any legal trademark rights or anything in America. So the term Kobe beef is pretty much fair game for any beef slinger to slap on their packaging. But a lot of the times, it will still just be marketed as American-style Kobe beef. I'm sure there would be a lawsuit eventually, so probably preemptively trying to cover their butts. But despite them leaving Japan fairly recently, there still are a couple of purebred Wagyus romping around. Notably in Australia, there's some farm in Western Australia that marketed some of their beef as wine-fed Wagyu. Supposedly, they feed wine to their Wagyu cows for 2 months before sending them off to slaughter. Purportedly, it helps fatten them up and, like, give their meat a better flavor. Okay, so like, even if these guys are actually feeding their cows wine, which honestly I kind of doubt, realistically it's just like franzia. But like, come on, let's be real, even if that doesn't actually do anything for the quality of the meat, still sounds really fancy. Like, wine-fed Wagyu, yeah, sounds bougie as hell, dude. And like, if you're gonna drop $150 on one steak, it might as well sound cool. So yeah, in summation, Wagyu's expensive because of artificial scarcity and because these cows are genetically built to be awesome. And you got to see a cow being made.
This is the finished product. I put some black acrylic over the face to make it a little bit more matte and cover some of the cracks that happened while it was baking. And you can see that the background got a little bit darker while baking. That's just what happens. It kind of looks like a halo in like one of those medieval paintings of the apostles or whatever. It wasn't really my intention, but it still looks pretty cool. This ear got kind of crushed while baking because I put tin foil over it to keep it from burning. And same with this tiny little indent right there, which is of course right on top of the cow, so that's great. Otherwise there were like a couple tiny cracks, but I think I covered most of them with paint, and that's about it. It's a cow with a kaleidoscope behind it. Okay, bye.